मॉड्यूल नंबर 24 कम बाय पिट बाइट एच अपरेटस एंड मटेरियल्स जिंक कॉपर आयरन ब्लॉक साइज 7 इंचेस इनटू 7 इंचेस प्रेसिंग एंड कार्बन पेपर एचिंग ड्राइंग नीडल स्क्रैपर और अ मेटल फाइल ब्रासो स्टिकर पेपर ब्लैक प्रिंटिंग इंक स्टॉप आउट सॉल्यूशन इंकिंग नाइफ हाफ ग्राउंड इंकिंग ग्लास पेपर फॉर प्रिंटिंग cotton racks and kerosene for cleaning, printing machine, hand glove, face mask, roller or brayer, rosin powder, hot plate, woolen felt, plastic tray, nitric acid solution, nitric acid 60% purity. Carefully choose one zinc, copper, iron block. Ensure that the block chosen is cut at right angles of 7 inches into 7 inches in size. Carefully polish the surface to be etched clean with Brasso. Next, this clean block is applied with hard ground and smoked on the side to be etched. Draw or trace the design or sketch on the block. This sketch can be further improved at the time of the final drawing on the block. The painter and printmaker Jan van de Velde IV invented the aquatint technique in Amsterdam around 1650. The cartographer Peter Fries Bertet later introduced his secret aquatint technique to England in the 1770s. Aquatint is an intaglio printmaking technique, a variant of etching. In intaglio printmaking, the artist makes marks on the plate. In the case of aquatint, a copper or zinc plate that are capable of holding ink. The inked plate is passed through a printing press together with a sheet of paper, resulting in a transfer of the ink to the paper. This can be repeated a number of times depending on the particular technique. Aquatint uses the application of a mordant to etch into the metal plate. Aquatint also uses powder rosin, hard resin, to create a tonal effect. The rosin is acid resistant and typically adhered to the plate by controlled heating. The tonal variation is controlled by the level of mordant exposure over large area, and thus the image is shaped by large sections at a time. Now, draw the image on the block with the help of the pointed etching needle or tools with light pressure. Aquatint is one of the processes of printmaking which produces elegant tonal values on areas on the plate. The rosin powder, which is heated to stick to the metal plate, creates a ground which can be easily etched upon. Once the procedure of getting the rosin stuck to the plate is done, then plate is etched on using a mordant or acid solution. The acid goes into the crevices and grooves created as per the design on the plate. These very cavities will hold the ink. A huge variety of tones and textures can be made and created depending upon the density, width and depth of the cavities created by the acid burns. The aquatint method was perfected in the 18th century by a printmaker, and a great number of pure aquatint plates were made. The technique was also popularly used along with line etching. Hence, line and depth of textures were ensured in the output of the prints. There is no limit to the tonal gradations an aquatint plate can create theoretically. It has been seen that rosin powder comes in a variety of textures. The finer it is, the varying of the differences in the edge. The more granular the powder, the chances of its fusing incorrectly could manifest. Hence, it is imperative that the even surface spread of the rosin powder be made. After the block is etched for 25 minutes, remove it carefully and clean the surface with kerosene, benzene, spirit. The plate is beaten in stages, hence there is a much deeper level to choose what the output comes out as. The gradations in tonal values can be created by merely a few seconds exposure of the acid to bite into the plate to a much longer exposure to the plate for a deeper and sharp lines or grooves. In today's times, many numerous plastic sprays are being used to make aquatints. These are basically lacquers and enamels which work the same way as rosin or resin. The ease of spraying them onto the plate ensures an even spread and less splotchy or uneven surface to etch. They can be used for small to moderately long bites and are available in pressurized cans which anyone can use. However, the process needs to be a bit more explored. Dust the block evenly with rosin powder. Once the rosin powder is evenly spread, the block has to be fused with the rosin. For this, heat the block properly till the rosin fuses with the block. Within the basic process of aquatint, several varying methods, grounds, lifts, etc. have been experimented within the world. The new age printmakers, in all their innovative restlessness, have come up with variations of the traditional aquatint with rosin and added stages before the plate goes into acid so as to control the depth and the tonal values created later. Some examples of such experiments are spitbite, gumbite aquatint, where the acid solution is painted onto ready ground plate. We need to prepare the gumbite, spitbite solution in the proportion of 2 part gum arabic and 1 part nitric acid solution, 60% purity in our bowl. Now this block is ready for gum bite, spit bite etching. This solution is ready to be applied on the block now. By creating a rosin dust storm in an equitant box so that the particles will shift onto the plate evenly. Apply the gum bite solution on the plate using a synthetic paint brush or an animal hair brush. Care has to be taken to paint the block as per the design's tonal requirements. This is similar to watercolor painting. After the rosin particles are on the plate, they must then be heated to adhere them. After that, the artist paints varnish or asphaltum tar on the parts of the plate where he or she does not want an image, and the plate is submerged in acid. Repeat the process of painting with the gum bite solution to get darker tones. The acid bites around each tiny grain of rosin. The deeper the bite, the more ink is held in the plate and the darker the tones will be in the print. The tones are slightly grainy, but they are even because the rosin was applied in a box. If the artist bites the plate unevenly by painting the acid over the prepared equitant surface, the print is called a spit bite equitant. This method gives similar effect as to watercolor washes. The acid used is a weak solution and an animal hair or synthetic hair brush is used on the prepared plate. This is literally painted with acid. Acid can be stroked onto the plate, dripped onto it, or dripped into puddles of water that have been painted onto the plate. Because the acid is weak and is depleted quickly in this process, areas that are to retain ink need to be painted over and over with the acid until the edge is deep enough to hold the desired amount of ink. It is not possible to tell just from looking at the plate exactly how deep the edge has become, so it is important to have a sense of how many times a given area has been painted with acid in order to gauge process. The application of acid to the plate in this manner results in the plate appearing stained, but the varying color of the stain does not relate closely to the eventual tone in the print. The other object chosen in the market, which is wax based and it would work as a resist to the acid, hence deeper and more tonal variation can be obtained. Many artists and printmakers apply this technique to create the watery, lucid imagery in their prints. Pat Shear, printmaker and painter Pat Shear, was born in 1938 in Newark, New Jersey, and currently lives in the New York City. Shear has attended the Pratt Institute in New York in 1956-58 and Boston University College of Fine Arts in 1958-60. She then returned to Pratt Institute to receive a BFA in 1962. She has been honored by both these institutions, Boston University in 2001 with a Distinguished Alumni Award and Pratt in 1991 with an honorary doctorate. In 1962, the year she graduated from art school, Shear was included in a group show at the High Museum of Art in Atlanta, Georgia. In 1964, her work was in a show called Drawings at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. Her first one-person exhibition was at the Terry Dynton Fest Gallery, New York in 1964. During that time, she worked in New York as an illustrator and a book designer. Around 1970, she became friends with Saul Leavitt, Lawrence Wiener, and other conceptual artists, and she made a trip to New Mexico to visit Agence Martin. She rose to fame in the 1970s with monochromatic canvases of roses and other images that were etched out. The artist explained, "I wanted to destroy images as symbol. To make the image a symbol for a symbol, I had to etch it out, make the image and cross it out. No imagery, but at the same time, endless imagery. Every nuance of paint texture worked as an image." Scheer's first museum exhibition in 1973 at the Corcoran Gallery of Art, Washington, D.C., marks the beginning of a career dance with painting exhibitions. She has also made installation work shown as Documenta, Ninth Castle, Germany in 1992, and it is an important printmaker. Crown Point Press began publishing her prints in 1977 and in 1983. The Spencer Museum of Art, University of Kansas, gave her a print and drawing exhibition. A print retrospective at the Cabinet des Estampes in Geneva traveled to the Tate Gallery in London. Scheer has had one-person painting exhibitions at the Brooklyn Museum in 1984 and the New Museum of Contemporary Art in New York in 1987, both of which traveled to other museums, many in Europe. The Contemporary Museum, Honolulu, the Honolulu Academy of Arts, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, New York City, the Museum of Modern Art, New York City, the National Gallery of Art, Washington, D.C., the Solomon R. Guggenheim Museum, New York City, the Tate Gallery, London, and the Whitney Museum of American Art, New York City, are among the public collections holding artwork by Pat Scheer. She is represented by Cheam and Reed in New York. Though with her early work, Scheer was loosely ailed with conceptual art and minimalism, she is best recognized for dripping, splashed, and poured waterfall paintings and aquatints which she first charted in the late 1980s. Scheer's continuous search for the essence of painting guided her to John Cage, who she met in 1980, and Agence Martin, who she visited in New Mexico every year for 30 years, until Martin's death in 2004. These two artists provided Scheer with enviable mentorship. From Cage, Scheer learned the importance of non-doing, the role of chance, and the separation of ego. Martin showed her the magic of work, invested their spirit into an object. Both lessons found direction in Scheer's poured paint paintings and prints. Paint, once applied, flows downwards, its serendipitous path rooted by its own unpredictable journey. Scheer intentionally removed herself from the action, allowing gravity, time, and the environment to determine the work's result. She positions nature and its elemental forces as active participants. In this vein, Scheer is also profoundly influenced by Chinese painting traditions and techniques, especially the inky marks of the 8th and 9th century, Yi Ping ink splashing painters, and Taoist philosophy's aspiration for harmonious, unfettered connections between man, nature, and the cosmos. Printmaker and painter Pat Scheer continues to live and work in New York. Health and safety precaution. Goya passed away on 16th April 1828. Health and safety precautions. 1. Store concentrated nitric acid and potassium chloride separately from other chemicals. Whenever possible, use diluted acid. Acid etching should be done with local exhaust ventilation. 2. An important safety rule when diluting concentrated acids is to add the acid to the water, never the reverse. 3. Wear appropriate gloves, goggles, and protective aprons or lab coats when handling acids. If acid is spilled on your skin, wash with lots of water. In case of eye contact, rinse the eyes with water for at least 15 to 20 minutes and seek medical attention. 4. Cover acid baths when not in use. 5. Nitric acid action releases the respiratory irritant nitrogen dioxide, which has poor odor warning properties. During the etching processes, flammable hydrogen gas is also produced. Concentrated nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent and can react with many other chemicals, especially solvents or other organic compounds, to cause a fire. 6. Concentrated acids are corrosive to skin, eyes, respiratory system, and gastrointestinal system. Dilute acids can cause skin irritation on repeated or prolonged contact. Concentrated nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent and can react explosively with other concentrated acids, solvents, etc. Nitric acid gives off various nitrogen oxide gases, including nitrogen dioxide, which is a strong lung irritant and can cause emphysema. 7. Always work in a well-ventilated area. If in a closed space, keep the windows open at all times. Once this step is done to the satisfaction of the design requirement, first put the plate in water. 8. Read the safety, handling instructions and caution labels on nitric acid bottles and containers carefully. 9. Always wear acid-resistant gloves, safety goggles, apron, and respirator while handling acids. Clean the plate block with water and white spirit or benzene. 10th, in the case of an accident or your need for assistance, make sure someone else in the room is aware of what you are doing. 11. Should the apt solution splash or come in contact with skin and is allowed to remain in contact with skin, the result will be a severe burn. It can be washed off immediately with plenty of water and follow these general guidelines. Always keep a container of cold water nearby in cases of an accident. If your skin comes in contact with the acid, wash the area immediately with plenty of cold water and soap for a minimum of 15 minutes. Get a medical attention. 12. If your body should come in contact with the acid, wash your entire body with the hose from the draining sink for a minimum of 15 minutes. Get immediate medical attention. 16. Moderants, acids, and inks can be water-based or solvent-based, and hence care has to be taken that if a student has any respiratory allergies, asthma problems, appropriate aeration is provided. It should be noted that the intaglio process fills up ink in the block crevices and the upper relief surface area should be wiped clean and over the edges too. 14. Etching needles and tools should be stored safely and one should always cut away from yourself. In advance, locate the nearest first aid box. A final registration is made on the machine. 15. When possible, clamp down plates to avoid slippage. Minimize the chance of carpal tunnel syndrome by choosing tools with wide handles, avoiding tight grips, and including hand flexing exercises during regular test periods. Set work table height so wrist flexing motions are minimal. Now take the final print on the ready damp paper. 16. Sharp metallic tools for techniques like dry point, etching, engraving, and mezzotint have to be used carefully and with a firm hand. Keep sharp tools under lock and key. The paper to be used to print is kept soaked and blotted half an hour before the print is taken and should be damped when being printed for intaglio processes. 17. Rosin powder is a fine dust which can get into the respiratory system easily. While dusting the block, always keep the nose and mouth covered and eyes too. Time 0 mark the addition number on the paper. Write all the details like date and signature on the print.